Well, welcome everyone to today's Coffee with Kendra. I'm Kendra Lee with KLA Group, and we have these Coffee with Kendras every few weeks talking about trends and strategies so that you can generate more revenue. And today I have with me Gord Smith. I'm very excited. Gord is going to be talking about selling experiences, and we were just saying that our whole goal in our conversation is to talk about how can you use selling experiences throughout sales and marketing. And Gord actually has been a guest on Coffee with Kendra. He was here last fall when we talked about selling experiences. His organization, Alta, helps companies to scale up their businesses. And they work across the entire company. They work with leadership, management teams, sales and marketing so that you can scale. And they work with companies that are between typically 5 and 100 million, but they do a lot of work with entrepreneurs who are looking at how do I scale up my business and then be able to exit in several years. So Gord, a pleasure to have you back today. Thank you.
Yeah, it's great to be back. I'm looking forward to the session.
Well, as we get started talking about customer experience, I'm going to do a quick poll to have you all tell us, do you incorporate selling experience into your marketing and sales strategies today? Or do you not? So let's see. I just opened the poll for you and tell me if you incorporate it in today. And you'll notice that I don't know what it is, so that you could do that. And Kathy is behind the scenes moderating for us. Kathy, I don't see any. So did I do it wrong? Says, oh, we've got some people that say, I'm not sure what they are. And we've got quite a number of people who are saying that they incorporate it into marketing and sales. Some that aren't doing it, but do know what they are. So it looks like we will want to definitely give people good ideas, Gord. So the majority of them, they're doing it in sales and marketing. And we have a portion that are doing neither or don't know what it is. So,
okay, I left a wide range. I'm going to do my best to try to cover all that. So thank you, Kendra. Kendra and I have worked together for a number of years. So I was calculating it just before the session. I think it's over 10 years. So I've been a customer and a partner of KLA. So, and I'm currently a customer of KLA. So this is what I'm going to cover. I'm going to talk a little bit about customer experience for sales maturity. I'm going to break down the sales process and give examples of what a good experience would be, you know, in lead gen, for example. What would leave the client with a good impression? When you follow up, everybody has to do that, right? You do a presentation and clients don't magically come back and say, yes, I want to buy. You have to follow up and you have to do it in a way that gives a good experience. A little bit about closing and closing well. And then I'll talk about a little bit about onboarding. So that's what I had in store for today. If you do have any questions, by all means, chat them in and I'll try to answer them as we go. There'll also be some time at the end to ask questions.
Yes. And everybody, we are recording. Gord has a ton of information he's going to share, and we'll send the recording out after so you can go back and listen.
Okay, so I'll just quickly, Kendra gave a very good introduction. My company, we work quite a bit in manufacturing, professional services, and technology companies. Clients come to us and say, you know, my company's 10 years old and we're stuck at 20 million. I don't know how to grow it. Or, you know, I'm really struggling with, an inefficient sales process, or I have a bunch of existing clients, but I have a hard time getting new ones, you know, things like that. And we combine growth coaching, sales consulting, and marketing consulting to solve some of those problems, as Kendra mentioned. So let's look at a model. So this is a, overview of you know, the sales experience. And, you know, and there's a little bit of marketing in here too, and what typically happens. And, you know, the one kind of data point that I had it, I got it a few years ago from a study, you know, on what sales winners do differently. And it was really groundbreaking research, because what it indicated was that, you know, companies have grown up assuming that either their product or service was the main source of differentiation. And this particular study, you know, was able to prove that from a buyer's perspective, and it wasn't, they weren't talking to vendors, they were talking to buyers of products and services, that the real source of differentiation actually come from the sales process, not from the product. And so
that's why people buy from people they like.
Yes, they like, and that run a good process, and that are collaborative, and that educate them on new ideas and know what the results of their solution are. So that's probably more critical in many industries than the actual product or service itself. So when you look at the five dimensions of experience, how do you generate leads? How do you follow up? You know, how do you close, you know, onboard and deliver? That's what I'm going to cover. You can see the stats on the right. Many, many companies are focused on, you know, CX, because it increases revenue. The better the experience, the more likely they are going to buy it again. The more likely they're going to say, hey, I worked with this organization and they're really good. You know, they tend to be, you know, drive revenue growth, more significantly, and they have much higher, customer satisfaction. So let me tell you, an example. It's literally from last week. So I do a lot of work with software companies and services in particular. I do a lot of system selection work. So, hey, I need a new ERP or CRM. I'll come in and map the processes and, you know, talk to the vendors. So I'm not going to mention the vendor, but I'm just going to share the experience. So I don't want to tarnish them, but so I'm running a selection, and I'm a best practice in the selection is always to reach out to the software providers well in advance, tell them that you're working in an RFP, give them access to the client, let them form a bit of a relationship, because then they're more energetic about pursuing it because they believe they have a reasonable chance of winning. So I reached out to the software vendor. And I look on their website, and there's none of their salespeople have any contact information, including their sales VPs and their directors. Zero, nothing. So I can't reach out to the directory. So I'm forced to the dreaded sales hotline, or the email info@sales.whatever.com. Yeah. So I call in. Hello, you know, this is the sales line. You know, please leave, you know, a message to press one. I press one. You go to the main switchboard. It doesn't actually give you an opportunity to leave a message. I go to the main switchboard. I leave a message. So it's in the generic mailbox. Then I go again. I go the next day. I go and I say, I'm going to call in and see if anyone picks up. Nobody picks up. You know, I left a voicemail, and, you know, in the main box, nobody returned my call. Then the next day, I send an email to the sales hotline. And nobody responds. And so I took the matters into my own hand, and I called into support, and I asked them to log a ticket to have a salesperson call me. So when they finally did call me, and it was the sales manager, and I said, look, I have a client, they're looking to purchase software. We're thinking about an RFP. And I said, you know what? You've started really badly. I just want to let you know.
Right.
Right.
And by the way, I am a customer experience consultant. Yeah. Yeah, I've seen it all, and you put everybody into a black hole.
Yes, absolutely. Right. So some other sort of things. I used to work at SAP. I have a lot of experience with, you know, I worked at Oracle too. And I have a lot of experience with the enterprise vendors, Microsoft, Oracle, SAP. So mm-hmm. I won't name them, but in generalities, going through this process is often not a fun thing for clients. They're very aggressive about closing,
yes.
Right? And yes. They push some unnatural acts, mm-hmm. and you know they're trying to manufacture a compelling reason through discounting for a mm-hmm. client to move sooner than they're really ready, mm-hmm. right? And there's a lot of negative experience from that in the sales process that lingers for years.
Right. I never forget that bad experience. Yeah.
No, never. Right. And, mm-hmm. you know, in the SaaS market, that there's a little bit of that too, I would say, the orientation there is around features and benefits, like talking about them as opposed to talking about what the impact or outcome of your solution might be. Mm-hmm. So there's a mixed bag out there, but these are the five dimensions of a good experience. So let's dig into a model a little bit about that. So this is, you know, the four areas that I mentioned: lead gen, follow-up, closing, and onboarding, right? And so if you look at lead gen, the classic, you know, here's what my product does and do you want some emails? They don't work, right? People are looking to be, we're for some kind of insight or higher level conversation, you know, kind of leading with that, some idea about, you know, what value you can contribute. If you have a hypothesis of value, those are things that all work, you know, when you're approaching a client, and that creates a good experience. The very product centered kind of approach clients tend to be not as enthusiastic about. So lead with insights and some hypothesis of value. You know, on the follow up, I'm going to give some specific examples, but it needs to be, a value message, not, you know, you see the emails, right? I see them all the time as someone reaches out to me, and then, you know, you'll see an email come that literally in the title is follow up, right? You know that you're not going to respond to that, right? Or it'll be like, three or four paragraphs of information. I'm not going to respond to that. Mm-hmm. On the close side, closing in a, in a collaborative way. So you're working with the client, is important. And then, starting the project, often the project gets kicked over to the delivery team or to somebody else to deliver. And, there's been, a very poor handoff, or the way they kick off the project is, kind of very mechanical and not very collaborative. So, all these four areas are the areas that I'm going to talk about in terms of how to create a great customer experience in the sales process.
And the follow-up piece, is that just follow-up to lead gen, or is that saying follow-up as you are going through the sales process?
Both. It's both, right? And, either there's, I see a lot of follow-up that's inappropriate, or it's in the wrong quantity, right? Mm-hmm. It's either just way too many follow-ups, or not enough. So it's a skill or a orientation that you get from being practiced at it, right? Mm-hmm. And nobody wants five emails, in a week about the proposal you sent last week.
No,
it's just not a good experience. Okay, yeah. So let's talk about leading with insights, right? So if you can think about a typical sales cycle, let's just say that it's an RFP, right? Or you're working towards an RFP, that is a situation where the client's need is defined, right? It's, and we call that red ocean selling. So, they said, we want to buy a product. It needs to have X, Y, and Z, and if you choose to compete in that area, you're generally going to be in a price competition or a capabilities battle.
Yeah.
Right. And so, the job of a really good salesperson to create a great experience is to introduce new ideas and perspectives to that client, mm-hmm. to change the rules or to change what they think of their needs, to redefine their needs. We call that blue ocean selling.
Yes.
Right? So you're trying to, you don't want to be in that red ocean. You want to say, have you thought about this? Or here's an idea that we had, or things like that. So let me give you a couple of examples of that. So one would be Deloitte. When I worked at Deloitte, I worked there for years. We would respond to a lot of RFPs, and you get an RFP and then you submit your response, and Deloitte's pretty good at writing RFPs. So we'd usually get on the short list, and the client would want to explain our RFP submission to them. And we'd show up at orals and they'd say, go through your proposal. Well, that's a red ocean response. Mm-hmm. Client asked for X, Y, and Z. You come back and propose X, Y, and Z. Mm-hmm. What we'd often do is say, we're here today in orals to talk about our proposal. But before we do that, there's three things that weren't in your RFP that should have been. And we want to talk about that. Right. So that immediately shifts the focus to redefining the client's needs, and you bring some insights to it. And that's a much better experience. You're much more likely to satisfy the client because you're bringing a new idea to the table.
Well, and you're distinguishing yourself when you do that, which is what every salesperson wants to try and do. You don't want to just be judged based on the price and the features that you have. And going in and being able to show them things they had not been considering opens up their minds and they look at you very differently.
Right. And you could bring an insight. It could be a research paper. It could be a white paper. You could bring that in advance of knowing it about an RFP. Like those are the things that creates a better experience because you come across to the client as you care and you're bringing more value than just talking about your product. Mm-hmm. Another example of this is I had a client in the energy industry and, we had relationships, in one division, in their exploration and production division. And we had a really hard time building relationships in the other divisions. So I could have just picked up the phone and say, hi, it's Gord. I'm calling from, XYZ Microsoft partner. And, can we have a meeting and discuss, some of our offerings. But that's kind of all about me.
Mm-hmm.
Not about the client, right? Which is not very interesting.
Yes.
So what we did is we hired an industry expert. We created a point of view. The point of view was very specific. It was about how do you make the economic decision to ship crude oil by rail or by another transportation method, right? And we wrapped it up in a presentation offering. And we went to the different business units and said, in this big, large company of our, a client of ours is, we've created this point of view. We know everyone in the industry struggling with, how do you make the economic decision to put it on a rail car? Mm-hmm. Do you want to see our point of view? And we'll walk you through it. Fantastic customer experience.
You elevated the conversation, right?
Absolutely.
To what they cared about. And even more, because the salespeople know to do that and marketers know, we're supposed to focus on the problem. But you elevated it to a very strategic discussion that they would want to have. And that differentiates you completely from just understanding what their problems were and let's talk about your problems.
Yeah, yeah. And when we got to those other executives in the other business units, they perceived us as a solution provider to the energy industry, not a Microsoft partner.
Exactly. Exactly. You were experts to them that they really wanted to talk to who understood their industry.
Yes, exactly. So on the subject of insights, try to compete in the blue ocean. If you don't have one, create it. That's mm-hmm. a great experience for a client.
And Gord just gave you examples of how they created it. So it doesn't have to be miraculous. It's stepping back and really looking at the company and what are your own insights? Because we all have them. We all look and say, oh my gosh, look at all these mistakes they're making. When
yes,
they didn't exactly. consider these things.
Okay, so the next one, next area is follow-up. So we covered kind of insights and how they help with lead gen, but also conversations and positioning. So, I've been the recipient of some very poor follow-up emails. So I have a couple examples, right? So, don't use follow-up. That's the first thing. Don't ever use follow-up. Use something else more creative.
Or checking in. Don't use checking in.
Yeah, no, those are all the pedestrian ones. Don't leave. You should have a clear call to action or next step. Try not to use cut a document or put an infographic. Sometimes I've used videos. I'll talk about that in a minute. So you want to capture their attention. You want to differentiate, show where you're adding value, maybe summarize, and then set clear next steps. Right. So let's talk a little bit about this. I'm going to move to the next slide. Right. So here's two emails. I don't even have to read them. Right. The email on the left is way too much text for me. I'm not patient enough to kind of read that. The email on the right is, it has bullet points. Right. It has a look at the title. It looks a lot different. They're giving two examples of value, one, two, bang. And I've had a lot of success with using videos. So I'm submitting a proposal on Monday to a new client. And in with my proposal submission, I will cut a video that explains our proposal. It's an RFP.
Yes.
It will be short and sweet. It will have our RFP response will be attached, and I will attach a white paper. So mm-hmm. I'm hitting an insight, an RFP response, and a video. And I've made a habit of doing this, and I've had several clients that respond to me and said, "Hey, we watched your video. It was really good." That's part of the RFP response. And you know, if they've watched it,
yeah,
you can report back, you can, you know, and, mm-hmm. so that's critically important. So, I make a point of that with follow-up, even if it's a follow-up on the meeting, you know, we have the meeting, you know, maybe we have a needs discovery, you send a follow-up email thanking for them time. You could attach a video that says, this is what we learned, mm-hmm. right? And no other vendor is going to do that. You're immediately differentiated and the experience is better. People would rather listen to a 3-minute video than read that email on the left.
Absolutely. And it brings it all to life again. They get to know you better. They feel like they know you. It's fun because you'll get a reply where they said, I liked your video, or I feel like you were right here talking to me. I was.
Yeah, I was. Yes, exactly. Yeah. So the other thing around follow-up that has really worked for me, that is, it's a little bit controversial, but it tends to create a good experience for the client. Everybody has had the situation where you submit a proposal and then you get ghosted, right? They don't call you back. Did I lose this thing? What's going on? And so rather than, you know, send, you know, 5 emails with follow-up or check-in in the title, what I like to do is send an email and say, hey, you know, we had a really good conversation. We're really excited to potentially work with you guys. I know you were, you know, the following things were really important to you. We haven't heard back from you, and I wondered if you could respond back to my email with, you know, with a number, 1, 2, or 3. 1 is you've just been super busy. 2, you've picked another vendor. Or 3, you know, this project's no longer a priority. Please respond 1, 2, or 3. And clients like it. And you just get an email back that says, oftentimes it could be any of those, but I'd rather, if they picked another vendor, I'd rather know. I don't want to spend any more time on it. Right.
Here's what I'll say about that though. There are people that use that at the beginning of the sales process. Oh, you haven't responded to any of my emails when we're doing prospecting. I don't think that's as effective at the beginning as it is at the end, after you've built some type of relationship, they've had a good experience, and now they're actually feeling sheepish that they did not reply to you, because here you have been very genuine in how you've been working with them. So at that point, when you do the please respond 1, 2, 3, they're more likely to than if you're doing it in the prospecting part where you're suddenly appearing more transactional when you do it.
Yeah, 100%. I would never do it at the beginning. So I already have a relationship with them, and I am kind of a little bit calling them out for not being responsive to me, but I think it creates a good experience, right? The other mm-hmm. thing on outreach, I'll just give a kind of a LinkedIn example. This is something that, you know, people just really need to get their sales teams to stop doing. This is, I get a lot of LinkedIn invitations. Oh, Gord, I just wanted to connect. And I'm pretty generous about it. I'll connect. And then within 5 minutes, I get a solicitation, right? Mm-hmm. That is a terrible experience.
Yes.
Awful. So, and a lot mm-hmm. of people are doing it. I probably get 5 to 10 of those a day, mm-hmm. you know? And so it's just, it is outreach and it's follow-up. And then I get these LinkedIn emails. I call those reverse directions. Why haven't you responded? Why haven't you responded? And it just creates an awful experience.
Yes. Okay. And we have 6 minutes.
Okay. I better hurry. Yes.
So, we can talk. I can answer your LinkedIn but we can't, we have to keep going.
So with the proposal, I mentioned this already, every time I send a video, if somebody asks for a proposal and they, I don't like to do this, but they're not willing to, or don't have time to go through it initially. They said, I just like to have a look at it. I'll send the proposal in a video. They have the document, but then I'm going to present the proposal in a very short period of time. Like, what is the proposal, rather than just sending it? Which is a much better experience.
Because they have to listen to you, and then you get to point out what's important for them to pay attention to.
Yes, absolutely. So that's a really good way around proposals. And then onboarding, So, you know, everybody has a kickoff meeting with a client, right? You're starting a new project, you know, you have a project charter, you have, you know, you need to do this and we need to do this and here's the scope and all those kinds of things. Rather than, you know, kind of do it a typical way, which is a PowerPoint or you go through a Word document, why not make it a collaboration? Why not make it fun? You know, use tools like Mural. You know, I use these for all our kickoffs. I use, you know, polls and other things and engage the audience, ask for some opinions, use some tech and make the onboarding like super fun for the client. You still accomplish the same thing, but their impression of you is so much different. They don't feel like, you know, you've probably been in those kickoffs where you feel like, you know, I think we bought something and now they're trying to constrain the scope. They're so focused on the project mechanics, as opposed to creating a good experience during the kickoff, getting people who are on the project excited about starting the project with your firm. So I would encourage these types of tools. There's lots of them. I personally use Mural as a whiteboard, a collaborative whiteboard that we use to kick off projects, and it works really well. But there are others, you know, screen shares and annotations. So we do this in the sales process too. When we're presenting a proposal at my firm, we are 99% of the time we have a pen, and as we're presenting our slides, we're circling the area that we're talking about. The client has a visual representation of what we're talking about. Yes. It's very compelling. We do this in kickoffs too. Mm-hmm. And it's an every unit thing. That experience when you're using a pen to annotate, you can, you know, generally we would have an iPad or something that's connected to the screen. We're presenting on our computer, but we're circling important things, underlying, drawing little pictures, right, et cetera, creates a great onboarding experience.
As if you were live.
Yeah.
As if you're live. And Jonathan asked, what tool are you using to create a sales video to go along with the proposal?
Vidyard.
And that's what Vidyard. I do as well.
Yeah.
But Jonathan, same. I use Vidyard as well. And you can go on as long as you want and screen share the proposal. We won't give a proposal unless you agree to a meeting. And if they can't agree to a meeting, then we're going to do it the way Gord said. Just because it's so important to be able to convey why you decided to do what you were doing.
Yeah, 100%. Okay. So in terms of a wrap up, you know, I gave you a half a dozen ideas around, you know, changing the sales, the customer experience in the sales process. The only other thing that I would mention is that there is an explosion of tech tools, you know, sales tech, right? And I certainly haven't used them all, but I think there's an opportunity with technology to continue to improve some of your processes around, you know, the sales experience, and, you know, things like Mural and Vidyard are some of them. Mm-hmm. Right? So I'd really look at your sales process and the tech that you're using to create the best experience for your client.
Well, and look inside the tools that you're already using, like Zoom and Teams. There are all apps that go with them, and you're looking for tools that will integrate with what you already have. At the foundation, you still have the same sales process that you're going through, if it's the right sales process for what you are selling, and you're still doing all of the marketing. So you, at the foundation, your strategy is going to be the same. Now you just have more tools that you can use to do that. And with the customer experience, the way Gord is talking, the center of that is always your client and you thinking about, well, how are they perceiving that? You know, voicemail used to be great, going back to Gord's comment at the beginning, but to be put into a voicemail black hole that probably nobody's even checking the box, and leaving your prospect or client who has a question now in that black hole is not a positive customer experience.
Yeah.
So go back and look all along the way at the experience that you are creating. Now, let me just share one thing, and we'll stay on for an extra 10 minutes. Whoops. Did we lose, where did the, oh, I have to find the slide. Looks like we don't have it in this deck. So I'm gonna have to tell you live two things, and then we're gonna stay on 10 extra minutes. If you've got questions, put them into the question and answer. Kathy's been funneling them out. Our next coffee with Kendra is in 3 weeks. I have to look at the calendar. I have a wall of calendars over here, everybody. It is on June 3rd, and we are going to be talking about building a sales team. So if you are principal led and you're trying to build a sales team, you're wondering when is the right time, or if you have had a sales team and it's not been as successful as you would like, we're going to talk about what you have to have in place to build a successful sales team. So sign up for that coffee with Kendra. Kathy has put the chat in the link, Kathy, or in the link in the chat. Kathy, would you put that in there again so it's at the top for people? Also, Gord has shared a great asset. It's called a CX planner. I actually printed it. And it takes you through how to plan your customer experience, and you can actually use it to check how good is the customer experience that you have. So do that. And also, leave us a Google review. Kathy, would you put the link for the Google review in for everybody? But leave us a Google review about how valuable you found today as we did our coffee with Kendra. Okay, so let's take questions. And I'm going to see. Oh, so the first question is from Raul. He asked, where is the customer experience sales planner guide? It's in the files, Raul. So if you go to the left, you'll see that. And Jonathan had asked a question about the video. Tell me, where else would you use video for the customer experience if it's not a one-on-one? So when we present the proposal, we're going directly to one person, or after a meeting, we're going directly to one person. If you're in marketing and you're trying to use video, how would you use that to improve customer experience?
Yeah, so we have experimented with a video in an outreach, like, you know, as part of marketing, like in a sequence. Mm-hmm. And it depending on the industry and the audience, we've had a lot of success with that because we can see the open. So you may have a, like, you're sending out an outreach that's going to, 500 clients in your target market. Maybe you're running an ABM campaign or something. Mm-hmm. You know, there'll be two or three videos of the seven touches, like, embedded in the email. So it comes up in Vidyard. So that's another place where it can work. Mm-hmm. And we had some success. So I would, if you have a market you think that would work, I would encourage you to try it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So think about the types of questions that you answer a lot that your prospects may have. And that's another place where you can have created a video. And if that question comes up, sharing that video or letting them know, you know, this is a typical question. This is something we hear frequently. So that they know, they get more information that you can share with them.
Yeah, I use it in the delivery process too. Like, so we're a coaching and consulting company. So when we're delivering a project and say I'm coaching somebody, mm-hmm. I may send them a 2-minute video afterwards and say, you know, here's what we learned in the session, and here's three things I want you to try.
Yes.
Or I might do it as an explainer, like send mm-hmm. We went over this concept, we're using this tool, we're applying it to your business. Then afterwards, we may send an explainer video that's mm-hmm. 5 minutes long that re-explains the tool. So it's easier for them to apply it, but that's during delivery.
Yes. And that's, so when you're onboarding, for example, telling them how they're going to use the tool to work with you.
Correct. Yeah.
And people like that because they can save it, they can bookmark it, they can go back to it in case they have questions. So that's a good strategy. What are some other examples of improving customer experience as you are onboarding a new client?
For me, obviously, those tools are really important. And having a good collaboration. This is not a tech thing or anything, but I like to dry run the kickoff with my sponsor before we do it, so they can, you know, I've had so many instances where they don't see the material enough before you start the onboarding process, and they, well, I really wish you had it done it this way or that way. So dry runs are something that I try to do with every onboarding, especially before kickoff.
You know, and that's a very good point. As if you are in sales, then you know the more time you can spend with your sponsor, the better. And when you're doing something like a dry run, always new information comes to light. Anytime you have a conversation, there's new information or how they're thinking, or you being able to share ideas. And that's very valuable for the entire customer experience. I'm going to take you all back to marketing, because we have had a number of Coffee with Kendras over the last few months all about websites and website refresh and SEO. You can improve your customer experience even in those types of scenarios. You know, we've been talking more where you're one-on-one, but what if they come to your website? You want them to have a good customer experience right from the beginning. Gord showed you it starts with the lead generation. Well, the first time they get to your website, you want them to be able to navigate it easily. You want to have different resources that you're offering them that would be of value, and you want your follow-up to be appropriate to whatever it was that they requested. So customer experience starts way the heck at the front before you even know who they are. What would you add about the beginning piece, the marketing piece?
That first initial contact that you make with the client, you know, that their perception is, that's formative in their perception of your company. Mm-hmm. Right. And so if it's like the example that I gave, my first impression of that software company is really bad. Right. And so your website or any of your initial marketing, all like the way it looks, is it relevant? You know, is it valuable? All that stuff, you know, really impacts, you know, anything from beyond that, you know, in terms of their perception. Mm-hmm.
You know, when we're managing search engine optimization for clients now, we spend a lot of time on their websites looking at what's the customer experience, what do we have to change, what web pages need to be updated, because you want that first experience to be very positive and have them want to engage with you. So Gord, we have just a minute left. What would you tell people they should do to get started? We have some people that are integrating it into marketing and sales, we saw at the beginning, and we have people that are brand new. So where should they begin so that they can integrate and improve their customer experience?
It really starts with a really good understanding of who your core customer is, right? And so if you cannot really truly understand your core customer and what they value, then you can design the experience that would attract that customer, right? So to me, that's the core. I mean, there's all kinds of concepts in there around core customer and buyer persona and, you know, the things like that. But I think that's the fundamental thing that allows you the right kind of information to design it. So, you know, depending on that core customer, lead gen may look differently. The way you interact with them and follow up would look differently, the way you propose. So that would be my suggested starting point is doing the right kind of homework.
Mm-hmm. So know who your core customer is, and then what is the experience that they want? And keep in mind, everyone, you may have identified an industry or a target market, but within that, whoever your core customer is, what's the experience they want? Because if somebody wants a high touch experience versus someone that just wants to be able to streamline through, even they can be in the exact same target market, but that's a different customer experience. And one may be your customer and the other may not. And if they're both your customer, then how are you going to identify the one that wants to be streamlined through versus the one that wants the high touch experience so that you're not frustrating one or the other because you got it wrong? Well, thank you, everyone. Make sure that you have signed up for our next Coffee with Kendra on how to build a sales team if that is something that you are very focused on now. And we'll be talking about that on June 3rd. I encourage you to go leave a Google review. We know how important the Google reviews are, and we value that very much. So please do that. Gord, thank you so much for sharing today what people can do to improve the customer experience. And we talked about both sales and marketing. We appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you. My pleasure.
Reach out to Gord if you are looking at scaling up your business and customer experience is one of the things that's important. His organization will work with you on your leadership, your management, your sales, and your marketing so that you truly can scale your business to the size that you would like. So thank you, everybody, for coming. It was a pleasure to have you all, and we'll see you at the next Coffee with Kendra.